Hey folks, gonna do a little troubleshooting on this air compressor over here, but before that I wanted to show the latest upgrade to the Alice Chalmers 10 horsepower phase converter. Obviously these casters, they were rated at 500 pounds, but I think that must have meant the total rating of all the casters produced on that day's production run, because clearly they weren't up to the task. So I got some of these, they're significantly stouter and they roll a lot better. So we have a little better mobility. And this converter got used last week. A friend came over with a big antique industrial fan, and we ran that fan with it. It worked beautifully. But of course, you know, pushing it around on three wheels is no fun, so that'll be a little more feasible. So we're gonna troubleshoot this motor here. It is, I think, a 5 horsepower, 3,500 RPM motor. And this was given to me. Okay, so I ran out of memory there. All I was saying about this compressor motor, it was given to me, was headed to the scrapyard otherwise, and the reason it was taken out of service is because the motor stopped working. And what I'm told is, quote, the motor was checked out by an expert and condemned. And so therefore I'm not really expecting a lot of miracles here. However, I will say this, I've been looking at the bolts that hold the motor together. I don't see any evidence that motor's been opened up. And this is a single phase motor, so it has moving parts inside it beyond just the windings. And it's entirely possible for something to go wrong mechanically without burning out the motor winding, and therefore it's easily repairable. That's the first reason that I figure it's worth at least trying to make a video on troubleshooting. Now, second, I still have their wiring here that I just pulled it out of the conduit. And the diagram is on the motor, shows how to hook it up. So this is correct for one of the power input leads. Now look at the other power input lead here, and this is also correct. However, this wire number 5 goes into the capacitors, and that's not shown on the diagram. The motor maker considered that internal to the motor. So we look here, we have one input to the capacitor here, and then it goes through this one and out this way and branches off two different ways, and there's two separate wires going inside the motor. I can't tell you how wrong this is, but I can tell you it's wrong, period. Now, these are all start capacitors. They're intermittent use. They're only meant to operate for a moment during startup. None of these are run caps. So usually when you have a motor that has two leads coming out that are supposed to go to the capacitors, one is for the start caps, one is for a run cap. So again, something's very fishy here. I also have the magnetic contactor box. It's kind of in a shambles, and I think that happened after it was taken out of service. So it did have overload protection, so there is hope that even with it like this, something could have saved it from just being destroyed. But the first thing I'm going to do is just hook it up, see if it runs, and see what happens. So stand by, and I'm going to hook up a test cord in place of these leads here. Okay, I got it hooked up there. Now, for this test, this is a 240 volt motor. And I'm only running it on 110 half voltage. And that, with no load on it, it should still work, but it might take it longer to pick up speed. And the rated running current for the motor is, I wanna say, about 19 amps. So it ought to pull very, very much less than that with no load at half voltage. So here goes the start, let's see what happens. You see that? It pulled the voltage down to 80 volts. I intended to have that on amps mode. So I put it back on amps mode. We'll go for one more start. Stop the pulley. I want to see how much running current it pulls when it's running. (24 amps) and you hear that snapping from the capacitors down there? That's not a good sign. So clearly something's wrong with the capacitor's hookup, and maybe beyond that, I don't know. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to take the capacitor wire off so that it's not going to be getting power from the incoming line. So in other words, I took the T5 wire out of the circuit right there, and I just have it pulled out. Well, that's a badly done connection there. So what I'm going to do next, I'm going to manually pull this out with it running and see what happens. So I'm going to put it in there to start, and I'm going to pull this out and break that capacitor circuit while the motor's running, and we'll see what happens. Aha, look at that. Now we're only pulling 4.1, 4.2 amps. So something about that start capacitor being in the circuit all the time is not good. So go ahead and shut it down. Now that probably left the capacitor charged, so I'm going to put it back in here to discharge it. You heard that snap again. One of those capacitors has a bad connection on it. It's arcing. So we'll do a little more in-depth troubleshooting of what could be wrong here. Okay, that's such a mess that I just drew it out on paper to show what's been done. So normally, you have the main winding goes all the way across L1 and L2. It always gets power. The auxiliary winding goes through the centrifugal start switch, and then that would be to your start capacitor. And then this other lead doesn't go through the centrifugal switch, but it comes from the same winding. That's the run cap. In this case, they had this crazy configuration going on. And all three of these are start caps. None of them are continuous duty run caps. Now, again, that's just kind of randomness. So we'll get another diagram here. This is what it should do. Again, there's your centrifugal switch for the start cap, and then bypassing the centrifugal switch for the run cap. So that's how it should operate. So if I take that lead number 7, which is the one for the run cap, and take it out of the system, the motor ought to operate and start and turn off the start cap automatically. So let's try that. So I believe that's 6. That's 7. So this one should be the one that's operated by the centrifugal. This should be the one that is always active for the run cap and not controlled by the centrifugal switch. And then this other lead here, number 6, is controlled by the centrifugal switch. So go back to the diagram, and we've taken this lead 7 that's always active and just taken it out of the system. And then the one from lead 6 that goes through the centrifugal switch, that one is going to the start capacitors. Now we'll put the start capacitor back in the circuit. Just tie it back in. So what do you think is going to happen when I power it on? What kind of current draw, what kind of reaction from the motor? Let's see. See, it went back down to that 4 amps like it was before when I disconnected it manually. Because in this case, the centrifugal switch is functioning. Turned it off. So, one step in the right direction. Go try to get a run capacitor now. You just heard the centrifugal switch kick back in. I don't know the exact rating of the run cap. I'll have to look it up, but I'm going to use this 35 for a test. You notice the difference. It's a metal can. This is an oil-filled capacitor, and it can work constantly without overheating. It's a continuous duty design. Much lower capacitance rating, but continuous duty. So I'm going to come in to this one because the terminals are less rusted with our power feed for the capacitors. Plug it in. And then the power feed is going to branch off and supply both run and start caps. And I'll show, I'm going to pinch that down a bit. I'll show that on the diagram in a minute. So we have the power from the line cord comes in, and it's common to both. It's just doubled up there. And then the two start caps are in series with one another to get a voltage rating. And then the run cap does it all by itself. So looking at the diagram, this T-point where everything connects together is this wire and this bridge. So the starting switch is in lead 6 on the motor. And if we come from here and we look at lead 6, it goes to the start capacitors. And that's just two connected in series. And the direct line to the auxiliary winding is in lead 7. And then we have lead 7 going right to this run cap. So we'll do another test start. Remember, it started up normally, and then once it was running, it was drawing 4 amps. So let's go for a start here. So now started up normally, and now we're pulling half the current because we have the run capacitor working. Go for a shutdown. The bearings sound a little old, but definitely have a lot of life left in them. So now let's hook it up to its full 240 volt supply and see how it sounds. Okay, so I got an AC current clamp on there and going to go plug it into its design voltage, 240. So it looks like 2.2 amps. Not bad. So I guess that leaves one thing. We'll slip the belts back on and see if the compressor will turn. All right, here goes the start, 240 volt with belt on compressor. So you notice how the current draw went down as it ran? Part of that's because that compressor oil warms up and there's less you know, losses in the compressor mechanically as the oil gets warm. So, I guess the moral to this story is when you have something not working, check the basics. Check the very basics first. In this case, incorrect capacitor hookup was the only thing wrong with the motor. Period. I mean, it was somebody put a start cap in place of a run cap and they crossed up the capacitor wiring. Not the work of a true expert. The work of somebody who had no idea what they were doing. And as a result, this compressor was cut off of its air tank and it was headed to the scrapyard. And thankfully, the guy that had it was kind enough to give it to me instead of scrap it. And for that, I'm real thankful, and I'll find something to do with it in the future. I always love saving things that are destined for scrap and find out they're not bad. That's always gives me a real good feeling. So you can see the information on the motor there. It's allowed to have 21.4 amps when it's running at the lower voltage, or excuse me, the higher voltage of 230. And we're running about 240 here, so it had all it needed on voltage. And we were pulling 12 amps with the compressor turning, so with it lightly loaded, it was pulling, you know, about half of what it's allowed. And I think, looking at this compressor base, I'm reasonably sure, because that was a Sanborn unit, I'm reasonably sure this is a Harbor Freight replacement pump. Because it's got the item number on it and it doesn't have any kind of, brand name. It looks relatively new, and I did check the oil before I started the video, but you can see it's still right on the money on the dot. Just needs a couple of air intake filters. A little bit of a cleanup job. And now looks like I got two backup air compressors. Got the old repulsion induction Century motor, and now I got this one. Anyway, hope y'all enjoyed this little brief troubleshooting. And remember, again, check the basics. Catch you later.